Today I'm going to make a classic medieval shield with a sci-fi twist. To be fair, I built a lot of shields, and for whatever reason, they don't always get tutorial videos, so this is me trying to fix that. Here we go! For this build, you'll need EVA foam puzzle piece floor mats. I found that the kind with this texture on the back works the best. Others will work, but sometimes the diamond pattern shows through. Don't know why. Thin 2mm craft foam, it comes in rolls, possibly the quarter inch stuff, but it's not a necessity. Contact cement, a Sharpie or highlighter, or even a pencil. Paint, filler material, found in the same department as paint, masking tape, painter's tape, sanding tools, a heat gun, safety gear, Beskar ingot, scissors, razor pens, and a box cutter. I start out with a sheet of white EVA foam because the end design of this product is going to be predominantly white, and when possible, I like to avoid the painting process altogether. It just saves so much time. However, I will also show you how to make a metallic shield for those of you going for the more classic medieval knight look. First, I drew the shape of a half shield onto the EVA foam. Because the foam is white, I'm using a silver Sharpie here so that I don't have to worry about bleed through later. You could also use a pencil. Typically, when I'm planning for symmetry, the dividing line should be straight. However, since I want this shield to be curved along multiple axes, like the inside of a spoon, I'm making the line a mild parabola, or curve. The more extreme the curve, the more spherical the shield will turn out. Although at a certain point, it'll become more difficult to keep that seam from splitting, so keep that in mind. This is a step up from my first medieval style shield, which was only curved along one axis. I cut it out with a razor pen, angled straight up and down. That's extremely important. If you tilt your hand at all, as if you were holding a pen, then you'll get a ridge in the middle of your shield. Which, I don't know, maybe you want if you're making a really ornate looking shield, but unless you plan that, it's gonna read as a mistake. So yeah, straight cuts. When it was cut out, I refined the edge on my belt sander. This is almost always necessary for props this big, because the knife blade dulls out as you cut into the foam, and it's a really long cut. The knife dulls before you reach the end of the trace line on something this big. To keep it from dulling, I periodically sharpen it on a sharpening stone. You can pick up a more modern knife sharpener pretty cheaply though. When I was satisfied with the shape, I transferred it to cardboard so that I could duplicate it again if I need to. Then I flipped it over and traced it onto a sheet of white foam in order to get the mirrored side. Then I heated up the panels with my heat gun, also known as a paint peeler, in order to make them more malleable. A piece this large is going to take a long time to heat up, so you'll need to be patient and alternate between heating the front and the back so that it heats evenly. However, you don't want to burn the foam. This gets hot enough to burn the foam. If you hover in the same place too long, it'll start to burn, which will be really visible on white foam. One preventative measure that I employ is I alternate sides, and I always try to end my heating process on the interior of the workpiece, because if that gets scorched, no one will see it. It's easy to hide a mistake that isn't front and center. After they were heated up, I pressed them over a curved surface and manipulated them with my hands until they had a curved shape. I'm using half of a plastic novelty Easter egg as an anvil for this. Normally I just use my knee, but I've worn a hole in every pair of jeans that I own doing that.
I tried to save him!
So, trying to break that habit. Stop getting gravel in my knee every time I tie my shoes. Then I set them onto a saucer sled to cool and waited them down so that they would retain their shape. They'll cool off pretty quick, anywhere from a few minutes to a half hour, depending on your local climate. When both of the sides had cooled, I broke out the contact cement. I went to a well-ventilated area and put on a paint respirator. You won't get a good seal if you're not clean-shaven, so keep that in mind. If you can smell the chemical you're working with, then it's not working. I applied contact cement to each edge and waited for it to dry. I applied a second layer because this foam seemed to be particularly absorbent for some reason, and then I waited another 14 minutes for that layer to get tacky. Contact cement has a working time of only about 3 minutes, so you have to work fast, and you can only do so many seams at once. Luckily, there's only one seam on this particular build, so it didn't take all day. Next, I moved on to the insignia. I do a lot of Star Wars builds, so keeping in with that theme, I decided to put a Jedi logo on this shield. I made the logo out of 2mm black craft foam. I started with the largest spike because it was easy, and it covered the vast majority of the seam. Then I cut triangles for the little spikes. Using my cardboard template as a size reference, I designed the wings. They are wings. Right? I get Phoenix vibes off this. Or like, kind of like that Battlestar Galactica Colonial Fleet logo. I think that's technically a thistle. Eh, who knows? This is actually the most complicated part of the build. Drawing something flat onto a flexible material that will then look correct after being distorted by a curved surface is no easy task. But after several tries, I figured it out and made a duplicate for the other side. Then I glued those on with contact cement. Super glue will also work, but but it doesn't flex as well. You have to be careful with this because the thinner the foam, the more delicate it is, and contact cement is way stronger than EVA foam. It'll try to do that thing like when you need a really long piece of tape and then it twists all over itself and you gotta start all over. It's the worst. But eventually I got it on there, and on the back of the shield, I put a little grip handle made from the puzzle piece strips. Yay, they're not useless! Before I could call this finished, I needed to cover the top and bottom few inches of that seam that were left exposed. For that, I used DAP Alex Fast Dry, which is white, just like the shield. And when it dried 20 minutes later, I was finished. However, a lot of people may have stumbled upon this video because they're trying to make a classic night shield. So, for those individuals, I'm gonna show how you can get a metallic paint job. Because I don't want to mess up my Jedi shield, I'm gonna demonstrate on this blank shield I built. I built a lot of shields, guys. I don't even remember. Honestly, it's getting tough to keep track of them all. This is built with a more readily available foam floor mats that you can find pretty much at any hardware store, and even some sporting goods stores in the exercise section. It was made exactly the same way as the white one. The foam all reacts the same to heat forming, regardless of color. This shield had to be blank though, which meant I didn't have the luxury of hiding the seam with a phoenix or a griffin, or any insignia like that. So instead, I hid the seam with filler that was then mostly sanded away. You can see all that's left there is what's in the center seam with no spill onto the panels. Because EVA foam absorbs the first few layers of paint, I covered it in sealant. In this case, that sealant was Plasti-Dip. But rather than using the standard aerosol spray Plasti-Dip, I'm testing out this product that came in a regular brush can, which means it went on much thicker, eliminating the need for multiple coats, but it does dry pretty quickly, which means eliminating the brush strokes is a lot harder. Also, it doesn't keep very well, meaning you'd have to use it all in one sitting due to its limited shelf life. So I'd say use it on large scale projects where you know you're gonna go through a whole can at once. Here's a shot of the back, which I also covered in Plasti-Dip. This should give you an idea of what you do if you know that people are gonna see the back of the shield and don't want them to see that texture. All I did was cover it with thin black craft foam and add an extra forearm loop. These ones are made from 4mm craft foam sheets. The brim of this shield, which was made from puzzle piece strips by the way, had to be a different color, so I masked that off with painter's tape and used newspapers to create a paint mist barrier, which hopefully will cut down on the spill. See, spray paint will hang in the air like a cloud and then precipitate down all over your work area. So you wanna account for that with drop cloths or a ventilation paint booth, whatever you can. Then I spray painted it with Chrome Automotive Spray Paint from AutoZone. They're not a sponsor, that just happened to be where I got it from. Oh, speaking of sponsors, this video is brought to you by my patrons. The name is scrolling by. Building a quality prop and presenting it to you in a video that's both comprehensive and entertaining is incredibly time consuming and expensive, and it would not be possible without the support of my patrons. Having said that, it's just barely possible with my current level of support. I could always use more. So if you'd like to help me continue to make these videos, then you can follow the Patreon link in the video description down below. Now back to the build. No, we're almost done. Chrome paint can take a while to dry, up to a couple weeks even, depending on, you know, climate depending. And I don't live in the best climate for painting. But when it eventually did dry, I removed the painter's tape. How's that going, in-cam Jake?
Not great, voiceover Jake. I ran out of painter's tape, so I had to use masking tape, and it is really having a difficult time coming up off of the EVA foam, at least the craft foam type. I have to be careful not to tear it up, and it is, you know, ripping into it a bit. But like I stated before, this is on the back of the shield. People aren't likely to see that, and, you know, you'd expect leather to suffer some wear and tear anyway, so I think it makes sense there. Great.
There we go.
I also add rivets, but that's totally a cosmetic choice.
These are actually way thicker, so this can actually just be a tension fit.
Nice.
And there you go. Two shields for the price of one. Thanks for watching, everybody. Hope this was helpful to as many people as possible. If you enjoyed this video, then you can like, subscribe, and hit the bell icon to be notified of all future builds. Templates for this pattern are available for download in the Etsy store, link below. Happy crafting. See you later.